Dr. Marcel Petiot. This man disgusts me more than any other murderer. This is, to my mind, one of the 20th century's most repellent human beings. I loathe capital punishment and think the guillotine revolting. I hardly feel a qualm about its slicing off Dr. Marcel Petiot's head. He would be just over 100 years old if he'd lived to this day. He was the son of a postal worker in Auxerre, and supposedly he showed criminal tendencies early, stealing from classmates at school. From that he graduated to robbing letterboxes. But it was conscription into the army in 1917, when he was 20, which lifted him above the level of the light-fingered small-town boy. While others endured the hell of the Western Front trenches, Marcel was stationed at a casualty clearing station near Dijon. The spectacle of maimed and gassed young men dying in such places was hard for most of the staff to bear. Marcel Petiot was probably indifferent. At any rate, he stole the morphine, which was and is the best relief science can offer for acute and incessant agony, and he sold it on the black market. But he wasn't a skillful crook yet. He was caught and charged with theft, but he managed a remarkable defence. Insanity, or in the more sympathetic terminology of modern days, psychoneurosis. And, wonder of wonders, the court-martial was persuaded. Instead of going to Jankers for the duration of the war, Marcel Petiot was invalided out with a disability pension and enjoined to take treatment in an asylum. And the young man, inspired perhaps by the opportunities for malarkey revealed in the casualty clearing station, started training to become a doctor. He was bright enough. He qualified easily, though treatment in the asylum took up a good deal of his time, and his mother claimed that she never saw him study. This suggests something of the posed, indolent insouciance guaranteeing brilliance which Oscar Wilde made mandatory in Oxford. Photographs of Petiot, however, always suggest a hard, sardonic personality with Gallic cynicism carried to the lengths of malevolent misanthropy. But this may be the wisdom of hindsight. He quickly proved himself popular enough with those he met from day to day. For the newly qualified Dr. Petiot set up a successful practice in Villeneuve. He employed a pretty young housekeeper, and it became apparent to all knowledgeable eyes that she became pregnant. Later, Petiot was to say, "She told everyone she was having sexual intercourse with me. In fact, I declined this honour." By that time, his story could no longer be checked against hers. The pretty young housekeeper had disappeared and has never been seen from that day to this. Such a mystery and possible indiscretion was no bar to Petiot's prospering locally. He was mayor of Villeneuve from 1928. He married and had a son. He didn't abandon petty crime, however. He robbed his electricity meter and was cautioned by the police. He robbed a store and went to prison, which brought his mayoralty to an abrupt end in 1930. Somebody robbed one of his patients, a Madame de Beauve, and killed her. Another patient, whose rheumatism Petiot was treating, told the town the doctor had done it. That patient died very suddenly, Petiot recording a natural death on the certificate. And Madame de Beauve's murder was forgotten. Another Villeneuve woman accused Petiot of fostering her daughter's drug addiction. She too died suddenly while enjoying Petiot's medical attentions. Somebody robbed the Villeneuve police files. For 12 years later, it transpired that the notes on these suspicious deaths had mysteriously disappeared. In 1933, Petiot traded up to Paris. He came to official notice in 1936 for the petty offence of robbing bookshops. But once again, his mental history was called into service. He was given a conditional discharge and required to take some more psychiatric sessions. For the next few years, he prospered to all appearances. He took a flat and a surgery at No. 66 Rue Caumartin, and built up a practice of 3,000 patients. He kept out of trouble until the outbreak of war, when he was arrested for drug trafficking. But it seemed he had himself become addicted, and the court was sympathetic to the stresses and temptations of the medical life. He got off with a £10 fine. It was after the occupation of Paris that Petiot embarked on the actions that would label him one of the most evil men of this century. He bought a large house at number 21 Rue Le Sueur. This, he said, was to be his laboratory. He continued to live and practice in Rue Comatin, but he employed a builder to carry out certain alterations at Rue Le Sueur. The wall surrounding the courtyard was raised so that it became impossible for neighbours to see inside Petiot's domain. The large basement was set in good order with a reliable boiler, and, for scientific purposes, a windowless triangular room was constructed with a periscope looking into it through a concealed peephole. A lot of lime was stored for whitewashing. The top of the house was unaltered and unused. The building was ready by September 1941. Very, very discreetly, Dr. Petiot let it be known that he was in the resistance and could help Jews, foreigners, and seriously disaffected anti-Nazis escape to neutral countries. He employed a man, ultimately he employed four men, to go round bars and cafes looking for would-be refugees. His first client was a man called Joachim Guzbinov, a Polish furrier who lived near him in Rue Comatin. Guzbinov sold his business and took 2 million francs out of his bank. In January 1942, he went to Rue Le Sueur, where Dr. Petiot received him kindly and gave him an injection against dangerous diseases that might be encountered on the escape journey. Guzbinov was never seen again. He was followed by a colleague of Petiot's, Dr. Paul Braunberger. A family called the Nellers disappeared. Each escapee followed Petiot's instructions to cash up everything they could and bring all their worldly goods with them in the form of portable property and disposable cash. The business throve exceedingly. Until May 1943, when Petiot was arrested by the Gestapo. The rumour of an underground escape route via Rue Le Sueur had come to their ears. Inevitably, you might think, with four men who genuinely believed in it touting its services around Paris. And the Gestapo had set up a scam. They forced a Jew who was in their power to go and avail himself of Petiot's services. The Jew must have thought he was having a birthday, ordered by the oppressors to escape from their clutches. The Gestapo may have thought Petiot would be caught easily once they were watching a definite customer whom they knew to have asked for his services. But Petiot, it seemed, outwitted them, for the Jew disappeared, and they didn't know how he'd got away. So they arrested Petiot. And then comes one of the biggest mysteries of the case. They let him go again. Why? Did they conclude that he was a useful ally, murdering Jews and opponents of the Nazi regime? Or were his traces so fully covered that they couldn't bring any charges against him? We just don't know. We do know that Petiot simply went back to his old activity of offering escape from France to any citizens who could pay for it and bring all their property to Rue Le Sueur. Until disaster struck on the 11th of March, 1944. The chimney at the Rue Le Sueur caught fire while Petiot was in Rue Comartin. Jacques Marquet complained to the police that there was an utterly nauseating smell and thick, greasy smoke pouring from his neighbour's house. The police found a note pinned to the door referring callers to Rue Comartin, and they telephoned Petiot, who promised to come over at once. But before he arrived, the police had summoned the fire engine. Firemen had broken into the building, and in the cellar they found 27 bodies in various stages of decomposition awaiting destruction in the boiler. Luckily for Petiot, the police sergeant awaiting his arrival at Rue Le Sueur was a patriotic Frenchman. He accepted Petiot's imperturbably voiced claim that the bodies were those of traitors and collaborators who threatened to betray the resistance, and the police sergeant let him go. It took 12 hours to secure a warrant, and given the top-heavy bureaucratic paperwork demanded by the German authorities, by the time the police arrived at Rue Caumartin, Petiot and his wife and 16-year-old son had all vanished. Inevitably, the German authorities now had to investigate the scandal further. Inevitably, Petiot's stories about the resistance fell apart. He had left 49 suitcases with his brother at Auxerre, and his haul included 66 pairs of shoes, 115 shirts, 79 dresses, and 300 handkerchiefs. He had spent the night with his brother after leaving Paris, and Madame Petiot was still in Auxerre. It was clear that she, like Marcel's brother, knew nothing about the grisly murder factory in Paris. But just what was that murder factory? Had Petiot actually been in the employ of the Gestapo, killing off loyal Frenchmen against whom they could not bring charges? Had he any connection with the resistance? Or was he a freelance operator like Landru the Bluebeard, who killed lonely women during the First World War? Actually, nobody could pay a great deal of attention to this problem in the anxious days leading up to and following D-Day. Not until the liberation of Paris on the 24th of August could the press give Petiot's murder factory much space, and by then rumours were afloat that Petiot was dead. His body had been recovered from a river. Well, maybe another river. Or had been hauled off to Germany to work as a doctor in a concentration camp. His wife, Georgette, thought he was probably working for the resistance. His secretary, Cécile Dielmer, said he was a gentle, quiet man, although he occasionally showed curious sadistic tendencies. Journalists who thought he'd worked for the Gestapo didn't hesitate to say so. And Petiot foolishly broke cover. He wrote to the journal Résistance in October, protesting that he'd been framed by the Gestapo, who dumped the corpses in his house while they held him for questioning. Their motive, he declared, was to create a newspaper sensation that would distract attention from the German losses on the Russian front. As for himself, he was a loyal member of the Résistance and still serving. It was a clue. It was possible. He was certainly not in the resistance under his own name, but his handwritten letter could be compared with the handwriting of all known serving resistance officers. And the writing matched that of Captain Henri Tarzan Valéry, who had been in the resistance for exactly 6 weeks and served as an officer interrogating prisoners at Reuilly. Valéry was arrested at a Paris metro station and proved to be Petiot under a newly grown beard. He was lodging in the Rue Faubourg Saint-Denis with an old friend, a house painter called Georges Redoute, and he had acquired the nickname Tarzan by standing in Redoute's window displaying his beard and hairy chest to the world as he surveyed the passing scene. Redoute was lucky to escape serious charges. He claimed that Petiot had told him his wife and son had been killed by a bomb in Rue Caumartin, and he had to hide out under an assumed name because of his resistance work. Plausible enough in the confused circumstances of 1944, except that Petiot's name and suspected crimes had been all over the newspapers. Petiot glibly changed his story again to meet the circumstances of his arrest. The 27 bodies in his cellar were German soldiers. He'd also killed collaborators and traitors. In fact, he'd killed 63 people in all, and he really had run an underground escape route, helping a number of resistance fighters to get away from pursuit. Several well-known resistance leaders would willingly vouch for him. He named them. Unfortunately, they were all well-known to be dead. It took 17 months to assemble all the evidence against Dr. Petiot. Victims had to be identified, their relatives had to be traced, resistance members interrogated Petiot to see whether he could prove any connection with the underground before he joined it under the rather safe circumstances that it now ruled liberated France. And in March 1946, He appeared before the Sen Assize Court. The sad trail of relatives testified to victims having disappeared forever after taking their possessions to Dr. Petiot's escape line. The resistance members testified that Petiot did not know basic facts that anyone in the underground would have known in 1943. The prosecution estimated that he had profited to the tune of over £1 million by his evil scheme. Petiot screamed and swore and protested. He declared that hundreds of resistance men knew him and would swear to his innocence, but he dared not name them because there were too many Petionists in the court. He tried to fight with his guards when in April the jury found him guilty of the murders of 23 of the 27 bodies in his cellar. If anyone ever wants to claim that French justice is unfair to the accused because it does not decree the rather fraudulent innocent until proved guilty pretended by Anglo-Saxon common law, I would ask them to consider the astonishing scrupulosity of suggesting that there was any reasonable doubt whatsoever as to who killed those last four bodies in the Rue Le Sueur. Petiot was not satisfied. "You must avenge me!" he screamed to Georgette as he was dragged from the court to start the year-long process of unsuccessful appeals, which culminated in his richly deserved death on the guillotine.